الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way He deserves to be praised, and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace and send His blessings and salutations upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In our last episode or last class on Al-Aqeedah Al-Waasitiyyah, we discussed one of the most fundamental narrations in Islam, and that is the narration about the division of the Ummah. Now, why is this important? It is important because it is speaking about the inevitable. It's a prophecy that was prophesied by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore, anybody today who brings an idea of uniting the Muslims, regardless of their beliefs, and think and claim that we can progress and then we can succeed, is emphatically going against this narration that already mentions that this Ummah will divide into 73 sects, 72 of which will be in the hellfire. All of them will be in the hellfire except one, and that exempt one is the one that is upon what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was upon and his companions. And so to come into the with everybody, say, come on, let's come together now and let's all be friends. People like, you know, Yasir Qadi, the among the most deviant people on the planet today, because of the platform that he has, that comes and tells you, you know, choose any madhab. If you want to learn Islam, choose any madhab in fiqh. And then also choose any madhab in aqidah. You want to be athari, you want to be ash'ari, you want to be maturidi, no problem. It's all part of Ahl-us-Sunnah. We will see later, inshallah, what a blatant lie that is. And so try to unite the people in spite of the differences, and claiming that it will bring about success is deceiving the Ummah at large. And this is why knowledge is important. This is why we need to learn the hadith and the ayat from the sources, authentic sources, and with the explanation of the people of knowledge. And the people of knowledge are those who stick to the way of the Sahaba. Otherwise, you will go astray and you will lead astray. And today, these speakers are for the most part leading the Ummah astray in the name of progressive Muslims, in the name of modern Muslims, in the name of Western Muslims, and we're trying to cope and adapt to our environment, and you people don't understand us in America. Yeah, Captain, we understand America. America, come on. We understand everything. Don't make it seem like you're on a planet and we're on a different planet. It's all relevant. There's right now those trends are global. Feminism, liberalism, any type of the homosexuality, all these are global trends. Crazier in some countries than others, yes, but they're global trends. I don't want to shift from the topic. We stopped at the statement, هذا الحديث يبين لنا معنى الناجية. This hadith explains to us the meaning of the word الناجية. فمن كان على مثل ما كان عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه فهو ناج من البدع. So whoever is upon what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and his companions were upon, he is safe from innovations. وكلها في النار إلى واحدة إذن هي ناجية من النار. And because all of the other groups will be in the hellfire except one, then this group will also be saved from the fire. فالنجاة هنا من البدع في الدنيا ومن النار في الآخرة. So the safety and the security that this group is given is safety from innovations in this dunya and from the hellfire and the life to come. We seek refuge with Allah from the hellfire. طيب. المنصورة إلى قيام الساعة. عبر المؤلف بذلك موافقة للحديث. حيث قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تزال طائفة من أمتي على الحق ظاهرين. The author, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, used the term mansura, al-mansura ila qiyam sa'a, the victorious until the establishment of the hour. He used this expression to refer to a hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said, they will remain to be a group of my ummah upon the truth, and they will be apparent. They will be victorious, they'll be ظاهرين, they'll be on top. والظهور الانتصار. ظهور is victory. لقوله تعالى فأيدنا الذين آمنوا على عدوهم فأصبحوا ظاهرين. Allah says in the Quran, so we gave power to those who believed against their enemies, so that they will be, or they will become, victorious. وَالَّذِي يَنْصُرُهَا هُوَ اللَّهُ وَمَلَائِكَتُهُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Who will give aid to this group? Allah and His angels and the believers. فَهِيَ مَنْصُورَةٌ إِلَى قِيَامِ السَّاعَةِ. It will be victorious until the establishment of the hour. مَنْصُورَةٌ مِنَ رَبِّ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. It will be aided by Allah the Exalted and the Sublime. وَمِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. And by the angels. وَمِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And by their believing slaves. حَتَّى قَدْ يُنْصَرُ الْإِنسَانُ مِنَ الْجِنِّ. Actually, a person can be aided by Allah's will through a jinn. يَنْصُرُهُ الْجِنِّ وَيُهِبُونَ عَدُوَّهُ. The jinn will aid him and will scare his enemy. How? This is from the matters of the unseen. That we are not referring to now people calling on the malaika or calling on the jinn. La 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 ya captain, do not confuse matters. We're talking about whom Allah Azza wa Jal uses as soldiers of His. We know that at the time of Musa, Allah Azza wa Jal used al-qummal, the lice, and the fadi, and the frogs, and the dam, and the blood. He used so many things, al-jarad, the locust, as the soldiers of Allah. Allah used them to aid His slaves. That's Allah Azza wa Jal does what He wills. It doesn't mean that you call on these people, He says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِلَى قِيَامِ السَّاعَةِ أَيْ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ فَيَا مَنْصُورَةٌ إِلَى قِيَامِ السَّاعَةِ. So until the last day, meaning until the day of resurrection. So you will be victorious until the day of the establishment of the hour. وَهُنَا يَرِدُ إِشْكَالٌ. The Shaykh said, here we have somewhat of an issue. A problem arises. What is the إشكال؟ وهو أن الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام أخبر بأن الساعة تقوم على شرار الخلق. The Prophet ﷺ said that the hour will take place upon the worst of creation. It will take place upon the worst of the creation, the most evil. وأنها لا تقوم حتى لا يقال الله الله. And it will not happen until we reach a people where the people will not even say Allah Allah, meaning the name of Allah Azza wa Jal will not be mentioned. فكيف نجمع بين هذا وبين قوله إلى قيام الساعة. So how do we reconcile between that statement of the Prophet ﷺ and then us saying that this group of Muslims will be victorious until the hour is established? Then the hadith says, but the hour will not be established until people don't mention Allah. الجواب أن يقال إن المراد إلى قرب قيام الساعة. What is intended? The answer is, what is intended is until close to the establishment of the hour. لقوله في الحديث حتى يأتي أمر الله. Because the hadith mentions until the command of Allah comes. أو إلى قيام الساعة أي ساعتهم. Or what is intended by إلى قيام الساعة, the establishment of the hour, meaning their death. وهو موتهم. لأن من مات فقد قامت قيامته. Whosoever dies, his actual resurrection has taken place, in a sense that he is already outside of this life and he is in the life to come, technically speaking. In the life, in the interval life. البرزخ والحياة بين الحياتين. لكن الأول أقرب. But the stronger opinion and the most likely is the first opinion. فهم منصورون إلى قرب قيام الساعة. They will remain victorious until very near to the establishment of the hour. وإنما لجأنا إلى هذا التأويل لدليل. Why are we doing this kind of interpretation? Because we have an evidence. والتأويل بالدليل جائز. You may interpret something a certain way if you have an evidence which supports it. لأن الكل من عند الله. Because the source is one. All of them come from Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب. أهل السنة والجماعة أضافهم إلى السنة لأنهم متمسكون بها والجماعة لأنهم مجتمعون عليها. They were referred and attributed back to the Sunnah because they follow the Sunnah and they hold on to it. والجماعة because they are gathered around it. So they are the people of the Sunnah and they are the people that are gathered around the Sunnah at the same time. And this is why they agree upon the Sunnah, in other words. فَإِنْ قُلْتَ كَيْفَ يَقُولْ أَهْلُ السُنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ لِأَنَّهُمْ جَمَاعَةِ فَكَيْفَ يُضَافِ الشَّيْءِ إِلَى نَفْسِهِ. So if you say, how come you're attributing something to itself, in a sense, because you are already calling them أَهْلُ السُنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ, so they're already جَمَاعَةِ. So why is that name being used twice? فَالْجَوَابْ أَنَّ الْأَصْلَ أَنَّ كَلِمَةَ جَمَاعَةِ بِمَعْنَى الْإِجْتِمَاعِ. The fundamental meaning is the word جَمَاعَةَ means to gather or agree upon something. فهي اسم مصدر هذا في الأصل. ثم نقلت بهذا الأصل إلى قوم مجتمعين. Then it was used to refer to a group of people. وعليه فيكون معنى أهل السنة والجماعة أي أهل السنة والاجتماع. So what is really intended is the people of Sunnah and the people of اجتماع, those who have agreed upon it. سموا أهل السنة لأنهم متمسكون بها وسموا أهل الجماعة لأنهم مجتمعون عليها. They were called the people of Sunnah because they adhere to the Sunnah, and they were called the people of Jama'a because they have agreed upon this Jama'a. طيب ولهذا لم تفترق هذه الفرقة كما افترق أهل البدع. This is why, subhanAllah, this is why this firqa has not divided like the people of innovation have divided. نجد أهل البدع كالجهمية متفرقين والمعتزلة متفرقين والروافض متفرقين. So the Shaykh said, we see the people of innovation like Jahmiya, they're split. معتزلة, they're split and divided. The Shia, they're split and divided. الرافضة وغيرهم من أهل التعطيل متفرقين. And anyone who denies any of the aspects of the deen, they're all divided. لكن هذه الفرقة مجتمعة على الحق. But this particular group is agreed, has agreed and adhered to the truth. وإن كان قد يحصل بينهم خلاف. That does not mean that there aren't differences between them. Even if there's a difference. لكنه خلاف لا يضر. It is a type of difference that is not harmful. وهو خلاف لا يضلل أحدهم الآخر به. And it is a type of division that does not cause them to declare each other's astray. Now, of course, the Shaykh, rahimahullah, was saying this. And sadly, some people did do exactly that. But they did it not in a sense that they declared the other people to be off the aqeedah. They just called them off the manhaj. But that's another discussion. I don't want to go there right now. أي أن صدورهم تتسع له وإلا فقد اختلوا في أشياء بما مما يتعلق بالعقيدة. The Shaykh said these are differences that are feasible. Actually, the Taif al-Mansura, the victorious group, they actually differed on matters of aqeedah. But wait, don't get excited. You're going to say whoa, and I'm going to tell you whoa to you. Calm down. Listen to the Shaykh. مثل هل رأى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ربه بعينه أم لم يره. For example, a matter of aqeedah that they differed on, did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam see his Lord with his eyes or did he not? ومثل هل عذاب القبر على البدن والروح أو الروح فقط. Another opinion, another matter they differed on is the punishment of the grave. Is it encompassing the physical body and the soul, or is it the soul only? ومثل بعض الأمور يختلفون فيها. So these matters that they differ on, لكنها مسائل تعد فرعية بالنسبة للأصول. It is, these are matters that are considered to be branches, sub-branches to the principles and the fundamentals and the roots. وليست من أصول, and it is not from the foundational principles. ثم هم مع ذلك إذا اختلفوا لا يضلل بعضهم بعضا بخلاف أهل البدع. And even if they differ, they don't declare each other to be misguided, unlike the people of innovation. إذن فهم مجتمعون على السنة فهم أهل السنة والجماعة. So they agree upon the Sunnah, they're the people of Sunnah and Jama'ah. وعلم من كلام المؤلف رحمه الله أنه لا يدخل فيه من خلفهم في طريقتهم. This is so interesting. And we know from the speech of the author رحمه الله that those do not include those who oppose them in their way. فالأشاعرة مثلا والماتوريدية لا يعدون من أهل السنة والجماعة في هذا الباب. The أشاعرة and the Maturidis are not considered from أهل السنة والجماعة in this respect. While this genius, the Shaykh al-Islam, the Allama of the West, Yasir Qadi, the Doctor Yasir Qadi, he, in his podcast with a bunch of people, says the exact opposite of Shaykh bin Uthaymeen. And if you want to take your religion from a person that you can meet Allah, you can stand before Allah on Yawm al-Qiyamah and say, this is a person I took my knowledge from, and you have Shaykh bin Uthaymeen in front of you, and Yasir Qadi, who every day changes everything that he believes about everybody. Which one would you stand with? Which one would you select if you have any intellect? Which one would you select if you had any intellect? The Shaykh said the Maturidiyya and Ash'ariyya are not from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Yes, Al-Qadi tells you, if you want to learn Islam, choose any madhab. And then also, you might as well choose a theological school. Athari, Ash'ari, Maturidi, ma fi mushkila. Learn whichever one, whatever makes it easy for you. At some point he says, what do you mean whatever makes it easy for you? What are you talking about? What are you doing to the Muslims? Ya Shaykh, fear Allah, you bring in calamities upon the Ummah, all of them will grab you by your neck on Yawm al-Qiyamah. You got a lot of people in the West You're going to have to deal with a lot of calamities that you're bringing with your Yale education that you have acquired that the scholars in Saudi don't really, really know about. Only you know about. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. So advanced in comparison to the rest of the world. على كل حال, the Shaykh said, they are not considered from Ahl-us-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah لأنهم مخالفون لما كان عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه في إجراء صفات الله سبحانه وتعالى على حقيقتها. Because they oppose what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and the Sahaba were upon in terms of keeping the apparent meaning of the qualities and attributes of Allah. They took them face value as is upon the way they're supposed to be understood. And that is very, very important. That is very important. ولهذا يخطئ من يقول إن أهل السنة والجماعة ثلاثة. That's why they are erroneous those who say the أهل السنة والجماعة are three. سلفيون وأشعريون وماتريديون. Salafis and Ash'aris or Ash'arites and Maturidites. Whoever says that is mistaken. فهذا خطأ. نقول كيف يكون الجميع أهل السنة ومختلفون. How in the world do you claim they are all أهل السنة while they differ? فماذا بعد الحق إلا الضلال. What is after the truth except misguidance? And that is a part of an ayah of the Quran. وكيف يكونون أهل السنة وكل واحد يرد على الآخر. How can they be people of Sunnah and each one of them is refuting the other? هذا لا يمكن. This is impossible. This is impossible. إلا إذا أمكن الجمع بين الضدين. Unless you're able to bring a relation between two opposites. فنعم وإلا فلا شك أن أحدهم وحده هو صاحب السنة. Otherwise, it's inevitable only one of them is the person of the Sunnah. فمن هو? So then who is the person of the Sunnah? الأشعرية أم الماتريدية أم السلفية. Which one of them? Which one of these three? نقول من وافق السنة فهو صاحب السنة. Whoever agrees with the Sunnah is the companion of the Sunnah. ومن خالف السنة فليس صاحب السنة. And whoever opposes the Sunnah is not a companion of the Sunnah. فنحن نقول السلف هم أهل السنة والجماعة. The Salaf are the أهل السنة والجماعة. ولا يصدق الوصف على غيرهم أبدا. And this description does not fit anybody else ever. والكلمات تعتبر بمعانيها. And words are according to what they are, what their intent, what their meanings are. The words are the embodiment of the meaning that they're trying to communicate. They're the vehicle through which the meaning is delivered to you. فلننظر كيف نسمي من خالف أهل السنة. So let us look, what do we call them? Those who oppose the people of Sunnah. لا يمكن. وكيف يمكن أن نقول عن ثلاث طوائف مختلفة أنهم مجتمعون. How can we say about three differing groups that they are upon اجتماع, that they have agreed upon something? فأين الاجتماع? So where is that agreement? فأهل السنة والجماعة هم السلف معتقدا. So أهل السنة والجماعة are those سلف in terms of their عقيدة. حتى المتأخر إلى يوم القيامة إذا كان على طريقة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصحبه فإنه سلفي. And anyone who follows that until يوم القيامة, anyone who follows the way of the Prophet وسلم and the Sahaba is a Salafi. Of course, the Shaykh rahimahullah, because we know from other statements of the Shaykh, which I must highlight, the Shaykh rahimahullah is of the opinion, is using the term Salafi here as an adjective and not a proper noun. The Shaykh does not agree with us dividing ourselves into groups and then having a group called Salafis, and then we fall into the same issue that other groups fall into. And this is in the Sharh of the 40 al-Nawawiyyah, and it is known. So I'm just saying this because we have a group of our Salafi brothers, we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to forgive us and forgive them, who have taken the Salafiyya يعني beyond the acceptable. They've turned it into a sect, and they've turned it into a small group of scholars that you have to connect with and adhere to, otherwise you're disqualified from Salafiyya. We say no, the Salafiyya is much broader than that. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. So we are definitely calling to Salafiyya, but we don't want to have another group like the Tablighi. We are Salafi. I follow the Sunnah of the Prophet according to the understanding of the Salaf. As for calling yourself Salafi, the scholars differed on that. It's not the point of discussion right now. على كل حال. وقوله أو قوله وهو الإيمان بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله والبعث بعد الموت والإيمان بالقدر خيره وشره. As for the saying of Shaykh-ul-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, and that is the belief in Allah and His angels and His scriptures and His messengers and the resurrection after death, and to believe in Qadr, the good and the bad thereof. الشرح, the explanation. هذه العقيدة أصلها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في جواب جبريل حين سأل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما الإسلام وما الإحسان متى الساعة. This aqeedah the Prophet ﷺ founded based on the answer that he gave Jibreel when he asked him, عليه السلام, what is Islam, what is Iman, ما الإيمان, ما الإحسان, what is إحسان, and متى الساعة, and what is the establishment of the hour. فالإيمان قال له أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره. So Prophet ﷺ answered by saying to believe in Allah, His angels, His scriptures, His messengers, the last day, and to believe in preordainment, the good and the bad thereof. Now, the Shaykh will break it down further. الإيمان, الإيمان بالله. الإيمان في اللغة يقول كثير من الناس إنه التصديق. The term إيمان, a lot of people say linguistically means to acknowledge. Or to believe something. It is to believe something. That's just one way of looking at it. Okay? Let me just double check. Yeah, it's like it's a form of trust. I'm just trying to refer to other resources here that maybe that have a better translation than mine. Now, إنه التصديق. فصدقت وآمنت معناهما لغة واحد. If you say I trust and I believe, linguistically they mean the same. وقد سبق لنا في التفسير أن هذا القول لا يصح. And we've already established in the tafsir that that statement is not accurate. It is not correct. بل الإيمان في اللغة اللغة الإقرار بشيء عن تصديق به. Rather, we said this is not correct, and that we have said earlier in the commentary on the Quran that this statement, rather إيمان linguistically means approving something out of trust in it. Approving something out of trust in it. بدليل أنك تقول آمنت بكذا وأقررت بكذا. Because you say, I believe in this and I trust and acknowledge this. And so you make that distinction between them. You make that distinction of you approving and you believing وصدقت فلان and you trusting someone. ولا تقول آمنت فلان. You don't say, I believe a person. Now in English, that's what you say. But in the Arabic language, you say, آمنت فلان, I believe in that person. You say, I trust that person, which is better. I acknowledge that person, but belief has a different connotation and a different variant in the meaning of the word from an Arabic perspective. إذن فالإيمان يتضمن معنى زائد عن مجرد تصديق. Bottom line is the Shaykh saying that it has a more comprehensive meaning than merely approving or acknowledgement. وهو الإقرار, and that is a form of submission. والاعتراف المستلزم للقبول للأخبار. والإذعان للأحكام. So it is a kind of acknowledgement and confession that necessitates that you accept the information, you accept the narrations that come to you, and you also submit to the rulings. This is إيمان. أما مجرد أن تؤمن بأن الله موجود فهذا ليس بإيمان. If you just believe that Allah exists, actually, if you just know that Allah exists, in other words, that's not إيمان. حتى يكون هذا الإيمان مستلزما للقبول في الأخبار والإذعان في الأحكام. Until you accept the narrations, you accept the revelation, and you submit to the rulings, you don't have إيمان. وإلا فليس إيمانا. It is not sufficient. It is not إيمان. And that's very important, especially nowadays, for people that are skeptical about their belief. You know, I know some people say, well, I'm not sure if Allah exists and if there's يوم القيامة, but to be on the safe side, yeah, let me do the good things. In case there is, then I'll be on the safe side. It doesn't fly, أخي. It's not going to work. It does not work this way. It never worked this way. It will never work this way. والإيمان بالله يتضمن أربعة أمور. أربعة أمور. Believing in Allah necessitates or includes four things. الإيمان بوجوده سبحانه وتعالى. To believe in the existence of Allah. والإيمان بربوبيته. And to believe in the lordship of Allah. أي الانفراد بربوبيته. Meaning He is the only Lord. والإيمان بانفراده بالألوهية, and to believe in him being the soul worthy of worship, the sole entity that is worthy of worship, which is the concept of divinity. والإيمان بأسمائه وصفاته, and to believe in his names and his attributes. لا يمكن أن يتحقق الإيمان إلا بذلك. إيمان can never be established except with all of those mentioned above. Now we're going to deal with the atheists. فَمَنْ لَمْ يُؤْمِنْ بِوُجُودِ اللَّهِ فَلَيْسَ بِمُؤْمِنْ. Whoever doesn't believe in the existence of Allah, obviously is not a believer. وَمَنْ آمَنَ بِوُجُودِ اللَّهِ لَمْ بِانْفِرَادِ بِالرُّبُوبِيَّةِ فَلَيْسَ بِمُؤْمِنْ. If someone believes in Allah, but he doesn't believe Allah is the only Rabb, like a lot of the Sufi sheikhs, who believe that their shuyukh and their maulanas help Allah manage the world, or the Shia, the Ithna Ashariya, the Ja'fariya, the Ja'farites, 12 Imamites, those who believe that their Imam help Allah Azza wa Jal, even do, according to them, even do more than Allah in managing the world, this person is not a believer. وَمَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَانْفِرَادِ بِالْرُبُوبِيَ لَا بِالْأُلُوهِيَ فَلَيْسَ بِمُؤْمِنٍ. If someone acknowledges Allah as the only Lord, however, his worship is not dedicated solely for Allah, he's not a believer either. وَمَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَانْفِرَادِ بِالْرُبُوبِيَ وَالْأُلُوهِيَ. However, whoever believes in Allah, and that Allah is the only one to be singled out in his lordship and in his divinity, لَكِنْ لَمْ يُؤْمِنْ بِأَسْمَاءِ وَصِفَاتِ فَلَيْسَ بِمُؤْمِنٍ. However, he does not believe in Allah's names and attributes, he's also not a believer. وَإِنْ كَانَ الْأَخِيرُ فِيهِ مَنْ يَسْلُبْ عَنْهُ الْإِيمَانِ بِالْكُلِّيَّةِ وَفِيهِ مَنْ يَسْلُبْ عَنْهُ كَمَالَ الْإِيمَانِ. However, the last one, some of the scholars basically, they deprive that person of Iman in totality, and some of them deprive him of the perfection of Iman. Meaning not every scholar will pass a statement of kufr, not individually, but they won't pass a statement of kufr on the person who denies the names and attributes of Allah. Some of them will just take away from him his wellness or his sound iman. He doesn't have sound iman, but they will not basically declare him to have lost it altogether. And some of the scholars say he has lost his iman altogether if he does not believe in the names and attributes of Allah. طيب, let's begin with the first one. Al-Imanu bi wujudi, the belief in his existence, the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إذا قال قائل ما الدليل على وجود الله عز وجل. If someone says, what are the evidences for the existence of Allah, the exalted, the sublime. قلنا الدليل على وجود الله, we will say, the evidence for the existence of Allah, العقل, your brain, الحس, the senses, الشرع, the legislation, ثلاثة كلها تدل على وجود الله. All these three indicate the existence of Allah. وإن شئت, and if you will, فزد, you can add another one, الفطرة, the natural disposition. فتكون الدلائل على وجود الله أربعة. So the evidences that we use to prove the existence of Allah are four: the intellect, the senses, the natural disposition, and the legislation. وأخرنا الشرع لا لأنه لا يستحق التقديم. Why did I say the legislation at the end, the last one? Not because it's not worthy of being put forward, لكن لأننا نخاطب من لا يؤمن بالشرع. But because we are dealing with people that don't even believe in legislation. They don't believe in the Quran and the Sunnah. So now for you to reason with them, you want to use the intellect, you want to use common sense, you want to use the natural disposition, you want to use your senses before you use the legislation. Because if you tell them, Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, Allah only created jinn and ins to worship, they will tell you, I don't even believe in your Quran, man. What are you saying? فأما دلالة العقل فنقول هل وجود هذه الكائنات بنفسها أو وجدت هكذا صدفة. In terms of intellect and logic, do we say all these creatures, did they create themselves, or were they created accidentally, by chance, by coincidence? فإن قلت وجدت بنفسها, if you say it founded itself on its own, it created itself on its own, فمستحيل عقلا, this is logically impossible. ما دامت هي معدومة, as long if it was in the state of non-existence, كيف تكون موجودة وهي معدومة, how did it bring itself into existence from non-existence. والمعدوم ليس بشيء حتى يوجد, the non-existent doesn't exist to bring itself into existence. إذن لا يمكن أن توجد نفسها بنفسها, it's impossible that it would bring itself into existence on its own. وإن قلت وجدت صدفة, if you say it was just happened coincidentally, فنقول هذا يستحيل أيضا, we say that's also impossible. فأنت أيها الجاحد, you denier, you stubborn person, هل ما أنتج من الطائرات والصواريخ والسيارات والآلات بأنواعها, all of these airplanes and rockets and planes and machinery with their different kinds, هل وجد هذا صدفة, was any of this found accidentally by chance. فيقول لا يمكن أن يكون, the person will say no, that's impossible. فكذلك هذه الأطيار والجبال والشمس والقمر والنجوم والشجر والجمل والرمال والبحار وغير ذلك, لا يمكن أن توجد صدفة أبدا. Similarly, the mountains and the sun and the moon and the stars and the trees and the coal and the sand and the seas and all this, how can this could never find itself by coincidentally either. ويقال إن طائفة من السمنية جاءوا إلى أبي حنيفة. A group of people came to Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, and Abu Hanifa was known for being an intellectual person. So these people from Sumaniya, As-Sumaniya, they came to Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, wa hum min ahli al-Hind. They were from India. فَنَظَرُوهُ فِي إِثْبَاتِ الْخَالِقِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. They wanted to debate with him on the matter of atheism and the existence of the Creator. وَكَانَ أَبُو حَنِيفَةَ مِنْ أَثْكَى الْعُلَمَاءِ. Abu Hanifa was among the most intelligent of scholars. فَوَعَدَهُمْ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بَعْدَ يَوْمٍ أَوْ يَوْمَيْنِ. So he promised them, he told them to come back in a day or two. So they came. قَالُوا مَاذَا قُلْتْ. So now they waited for his answer. قَالَ أَنَا أُفَكِّرُ فِي سَفِينَةٍ مَمْلُوءَةٍ مِنَ الْبَضَائِعِ وَالْأَرْزَاقِ. I am thinking, I am imagining a ship that is full of merchandise and provision. جَاءَتْ تَشُقُّ عِبَابَ الْمَاءِ. It came crossing and splitting the waves of the sea. حَتَّى أَرْسَتْ فِي الْمِنَاءِ. Until it stopped at the dock. وَنَزَّلَتْ الْحُمُولَةِ. And then it unloaded the merchandise and whatever it had on it. وذهبت. And then it went away. وليس لها قائد ولا حملون. However, there was no captain leading the boat, and there were no labor workers unloading the merchandise. قالوا تفكر. They said, this is what you're thinking about? So they wanted to make fun of him. That's what you're thinking about? قال نعم. He said yes. قالوا إذا ليس لك عقل. They said, يا شيخ, you have no brain, man. What are you sitting here thinking? هل يعقل أي أن سفينة تأتي بدون قائد وتنزل وتتنصرف؟ Is it possible that a boat, a ship will come without a captain and it will unload and go away? هذا ليس معقول يا شيخ, that's impossible. قال كيف لا تعقلون هذا؟ He said, how do you not find that reasonable? However you find reasonable, وتعقلون أن هذه السماوات والشمس والقبر والنجوم والجبال والشجر والدواب الناس كلها بدون صانع. But you find it reasonable that the heavens and the sun and the moon, and the stars, and the mountains, and the trees, and the animals, and people, all of them don't have a manufacturer. They don't have a maker. They don't have a creator. فَعَرَفُوا أَنَّ الرَّجُلَ خَطَوَهُمْ بِعُقُولِهِمْ. Then they understood that he was trying to speak to their logic. وَعَجَزُوا عَنْ جَوَابِهِ هَذَا أَوْ مَعْنَى. And they were not able to respond to him whatsoever. Of course, if you say this today to the modern day 2020 post-COVID-19 atheist, you will hear answers until tomorrow morning. Until tomorrow morning. The molecules with the gravity when they came, because Darwin thought that Hawkins was mocking the Dawkins, and all of them were going, and Ya Sheikh, please zip it. Those crazy atheists, Ya Ammi, I've never seen more feeble-minded people in my life. They yap. They just go memorize a dictionary, and then they come and use all these fancy words so that you try to get a grip of what they're saying. But the bottom line is that they're saying nothing. They are saying nothing. How can... Anyways, I'm repeating myself because I am baffled with the stuff that I see in here. على كل حال, وقيل لعربي من البادية. It was said to an Arab, a Bedouin Arab. Huh? It was said to him, بِمَا عَرِفْتَ رَبَّكَ. How did you recognize and know your Lord? قَالَ الْأَثَرُ يَدُلُّ عَلَى الْمَسِيرِ. He said, the tracks indicate the direction, or the footprints indicate that someone was there. وَالْبَعْرَةُ تَدُلُّ عَلَى الْبَعِيرِ. And sorry, the dung indicates a camel. If you see a camel dung, يعني, you're not going to think it just came from nowhere. فَسَمَاءٌ ذَاتِ أَبْرَاجٍ. So we have skies that have towers. وَأَرْضٌ ذَاتِ فِجَاجٍ. An earth that have paths. فِجَاجٍ, as Allah says in Surah Tuh. وَبِحَارٍ ذَاتِ أَمْوَاجٍ. And oceans with waves. أَلَا تَدُلُّ عَلَى السَّمِيعِ الْبَصِيرِ. Does that not indicate and guide you to the all-hearing and all-seeing? وَلِهَذَا قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ. Surah Al-Tur, Ayah 35. So were they created out of nothing, or are they the creators? And that is a question that no one can answer if they want to be honest with themselves. No atheist can give you a logical answer. He will try to confuse you, but don't be confused. I'm saying this because the Muslims need to be careful of this trend. Yeah? Your children. Look out for your children, my brothers and sisters. Know how to answer. Know how to deal. Know how to defend. Know how to explain. Know how to disseminate this information. You need to learn. You need to learn. That's why these classes are important. Because when your aqeedah is sound, then inshallah, nothing will shake it. Nothing will shake it. But if your aqeedah is weak, then any doubt, any shubuha will throw you off instantaneously. فَحِينَئِذٍ يَقُونُ الْعَقْلُ دَالًّا دَلَالَةً قَطْعِيَّةً عَلَى وُجُودِ اللَّهِ. So now that the Shaykh said, therefore we say that the mind, the intellect, firmly establishes the existence of Allah. وَأَمَّا دَلَالَةُ الْحِسِّ عَلَى وُجُودِ اللَّهِ. As for the evidence of, what did I call his earlier? The senses. فَإِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ يَدْعُ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ يَقُولُ يَا رَبْ وَيَدْعُ الشَّيْءُ ثُمَّ يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ فِيهِ. The person calls on Allah and he says, my Lord, and he asks for something, then Allah Azza wa Jal gives him that. وَهَذِي دَلَالَةُ حِسِّ. This is a tangible, it's a tangible practical experience. هو نفسه لم يدع إلا الله. He didn't call on anyone but Allah. واستجاب الله له. And Allah responded to him. رأى ذلك رأي العين. And he saw this with his own eye. وكذلك نحن نسمع عمن سبق وعمن في عصرنا أن الله استجاب له. And also, if not in our own experience, we learn from people that have called on to Allah عز وجل, and Allah عز وجل responded to them and he answered them. From the previous generations, from current generations, and everybody has an experience of that. I am sure, unless we are doing everything wrong to the point that a dua is not accepted at all, that you've asked Allah for things that Allah Azza wa Jal has given you, and sometimes Allah gives you and you don't even pay attention, you don't even remember that you'd asked Allah for these things. فالأعرابي الذي دخل والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يخطب الناس يوم الجمعة قال هلكت الأموال وانقطعت السبل فادعوا الله يغيثنا. And Bedouin entered upon the Prophet ﷺ when he was given khutbah to the people on the day of Jumu'ah. And he said to him that our wealth has been destroyed and the paths have been cut off. And beg Allah, call on Allah so that he may supply us with water. So that Allah Azza wa Jal will shower us with water, provide us with rain. قال أنس والله ما في السماء من سحابة ولا قزعة. He said this, and I said, wallahi, when the man said this, there was not even a piece of cloud in the sky. وَمَا بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَا سَلْعٍ جَبَلْ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ تَمْجَدْ سَحَبْ مِنْ بَيْتٍ وَلَا دَارٍ. And there's no, and there was no house nor a home between us and that place, that mountain near Medina. وَبَعْدَ دُعَاءِ الرَّسُولِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَوْرًا خَرَجَتْ سَحَابَةً مِثْلَ التَّرَسْ. Right after the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a cloud came out like a taras, which is a shield. وارتفعت في السماء, and it ascended in the skies. وانتشرت, then it spread. ورعدت, then there was thunder and lightning. وبرقت, and lightning. ونزل المطر, and the rain came down. فما نزل الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا والمطر يتحادر من لحيته عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Prophet ﷺ did not go down from the minbar except that the water was sprinkling from his beard صلى الله عليه وسلم. وهذا أمر واقع يدل على وجود الخالق دلالة حسية. This is an evidence, this is a factual matter that indicates the existence of Allah Azza wa Jal and the existence of the Creator through our senses, through something that we experience. وفي القرآن كثير من هذا مثل وأيوب إذ نادى ربه أني مسني الضر وأنت أرحم الراحمين فاستجبنا له. There are many examples of the Quran of something similar. We have the story of Ayyub, and remember Ayyub when he cried to his Lord, "Verily distress has seized me, and you are the most merciful." So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "So we answered his call." وغير ذلك بآيات, and other ayat of this nature. وأما دلالة الفطرة, as for the indication of the natural disposition, فإن كثيرا من الناس الذين لم تنحرف فطرهم يؤمنون بوجود الله. Many people whose natural instincts and disposition have not been distorted, they believe in Allah. حتى البهائم العجم أو العجم تؤمن بوجود الله. Even the cattle, even the animals that don't comprehend, don't understand, they're cattle, they're animals. They understand without intelligence. They believe in the existence of Allah. وقصة النملة التي رويت عن سليمان عليه السلام. The story that was attributed to Sulaiman about the ant who went out seeking rain from Allah. خرج يستهي, he went out to seek rain. فوجد أن مستلقي على ظهره. He saw an ant lying on its back. رافعة قوائمها نحو السماء. And it has its arms and legs raised to the sky, saying اللهم. It's saying, oh Allah, أنا خلق من خلقك. I am a creature of your creation. فلا تمنع عنا سقياك. Do not prevent us from your from water, from rain. فقال ارجعوا فقد سقيتم بدعوة غيركم. He said, go back because Allah has responded to the dua of someone else. فالفطرة مجبولة على معرفة الله عز وجل وتوحيده. So then the fitra is basically, how do I put it? The fitra is molded. It is created by default, in its default state, to know the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal and to single Him out in worship. It is inclined by its nature. It's inclined. That's what I'm looking for. It's inclined to know Allah Azza wa Jal and to single Him out in worship. وَقَدْ أَشَارَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى إِلَى ذَلِكَ فِي قَوْلِهِ. Allah mentioned that already in the Quran by saying, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا أَن تَقُولُوا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ أَوْ تَقُولُوا إِنَّمَا أَشْرَكَ آبَاؤُنَا مِنْ قَبْلُ وَكُنَّا ذُرِّيَّةً مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ. And remember when your Lord brought forth from the children of Adam from their loins their seed and made them testify as to themselves, saying, am I not your Lord? They said, yes, we testify. Lest you should say on the day of judgment, verily we have been unaware of this. Or lest you should say, it was only our fathers aforetime who took others as partners in worship along with Allah, and we were merely their descendants after them. So Allah Azza wa Jal will not accept that excuse. فهذه الآية تدل على أن الإنسان مجبول بفطرته على شهادته بوجود الله وربوبيته. So this ayah indicates that the human being is inclined in his natural disposition to bear witness that Allah Azza wa Jal exists and that He is the Lord. وسواءنا قلنا إن الله استخرجهم من ظهر آدم واستشهدهم. Whether we say that Allah Azza wa Jal actually took them from the loins of their father Adam and He made them bear witness, أو قلنا إن هذا هو ما ركب الله تعالى في فطرهم من الإقرار به, فإن الآية تدل على أن الإنسان يعرف ربه بفطرته. Whether it happened in the physical sense, and we obviously, because we don't remember it, the issue that the people have here is that they don't remember. So whether that actually happened in that sense, or whether that Allah Azza wa Jal installed that in our fitra, whether you recall the event or you don't, the fact that Allah made it part of the human being, part of the natural disposition of the human being, is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is your Lord. So regardless, we are on the same page. هذه أدلة أربعة تدل على وجود الله سبحانه وتعالى. So these are four evidences that indicate the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the last one we will mention, وَأَمَّا دَلَالَةُ الشَّرْعِ, as for the evidence of legislation, لِأَنَّ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرُّسُلُ مِنْ شَرَائِعِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى الْمُتَضَمِّنَ لِجَمِيعِ مَا يُصْلِحُ الْخَلْقِ يدل على أن الذي أرسل الذي بها رب أيوة الذي أرسل بها رب رحيم حكيم. All of the legislations that the messengers brought, which are inclusive of whatever is beneficial for the creation, all of them suggest that they were sent by a Lord who is merciful and wise. ولا سيما هذا القرآن المجيد, specifically this glorious Quran, الذي أعجز البشر والجن أن يأتوا بمثله, that both the human and the jinn have been unable to produce anything the like thereof. So inshallah ta'ala, with this I will conclude. I will open the floor for some questions inshallah, hopefully they're relevant to the topic. And inshallah ta'ala, next week بإذن الله عز وجل, we will, in the next session actually, I don't know if next week is going to be Eid or something, I'm not sure right now, we will discuss we'll continue on the discussion of the malaika and other aspects of faith. So Zakum Allah khair, and let's see if we have any questions over here. Assalamu alaikum Sheikh. I'm not a Sheikh. Wa alaikum salam. Since the Ash'aris are the majority, what is the claim? What if they claim to be the main body of Muslims? That is not how it works. Actually, this is something that we will discuss in the book later on, inshallah. We will discuss this in the book later on. But that is not what is intended by the Prophet ﷺ. when he said that al-Jama'ah and stick to the Jama'ah. The Jama'ah, as the Salaf say, is whatever agrees with the truth, even if you're by yourself. It is not about numbers. Allah says in the Quran, "An tuti' akthara man fil ardi yudilluk an sabilillah." If you obey the majority of people on earth, they will mislead you from the path of Allah. So that is clearly not speaking about the numbers. It is not speaking. So even if the Ash'aris are the majority, and towards the end of time, most people will be deviant. It doesn't mean that Islam, the truth of Islam, is going to be compromised in any way, shape, or form. Will the 72 sects be in Jannah forever? No, very good question. No. That those sects, that's why when the Prophet ﷺ said, "My Ummah will divide," that means those are people that are still within the fold of Islam. And we know from the Aqeedah of Al-Sunnah Jama'ah, anyone who dies upon Islam, the true Islam, even if he gets punished in the hellfire for thousands of years for the sins they've committed, they will eventually go to Jannah. So because we're speaking about people within the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, all of those people will actually wind up in Jannah at the end. So the Taif al-Mansura is the one that will not enter Jannah at all. It will not enter Jahannam, sorry, at all. It will go straight to Jannah. The other 72 will be subject to the hellfire. Allah might forgive. But they are entitled and they are deserving of the hellfire initially. Now whether Allah Azza wa Jal punishes them in the Jahannam, then takes them out, or Allah forgives them, takes them to Jannah, this is Allah's decision. On Yawm Al-Qiyamah, it is not ours. But that means that we are not referring to the Qadiyanis, because they're not from the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ. And we're not referring to the hardcore grave worshippers, because they're not from the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ. And we're not referring to the Nation of Islam, because they're not from the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ. So those people don't even qualify to be of the Ummah. They're not even from the 73 sect. They are in a religion of their own. They have their own religion completely. Very good question. Another one coming through. What's up? Can I continue to make the dua for my grandparents who were of those who visited the graves, but they were unaware of the true Aqeedah and they considered this to be the true Islam? Allahu A'lam. If you really know that they didn't know, Allahu A'lam. That's a very technical issue. I can't give you a fatwa. I'm sorry. If I obey the Quran and the Sunnah, isn't that enough? Or is it must that I follow a madhab? The madhab is not something you have to follow. The madhab is something that you learn. If you want to become a student of knowledge, then you learn the other madhab if you want. What you need to do is follow the Quran and the Sunnah and the mufti that you trust. The mufti that you trust will inevitably wind up referring to one of these four madhab. There's no way around it. Alright? No, you don't have to follow a madhab. Who is an Ikhwani, please? An Ikhwani is a person that belongs to a group called Ikhwan al-Muslimin. They are a political group that basically are willing to sell their religion at any cost in order to take power, to take over and be in the position of power. They want to run governments. And so they do this at any cost. They will mix with any deviant person on earth to reach their objectives. And everything in their religion is compromised. The Aqeedah is compromised, the Fiqh is compromised, the Manhaj is compromised. Everything gets compromised with them. May Allah guide them. Can you please tell us why the Jami'ah and Mu'tazila are included in Ijma' despite being in Kufr? Nobody said that they are in Kufr. We did not say that there's no agreement that they are in Kufr. And who said that they are included in the Ijma'? In Ijma' in what sense? In the Ijma' and the Fiqh matters? Or the Ijma' and the Aqeedah matters. Anyways, I'm not aware of the fact that the people have automatically disqualified them from Islam. We will see later on in the book that this is not black and white. Ash'aris come after Abu Hassan Ash'ari, so it's irrelevant. What was the belief, the companies of the Prophet? I don't understand the question, I'm sorry. Assalamu alaikum, brother. Wa alaikum salam. Is hanging Quran verses or dua on the wall to help you memorize or remember bid'ah, not for decoration? Ya akhi, yani, really bro? Yani, how many times do you, how much are you going to put on the wall to be able to, for you to memorize it? You can memorize it from the phone. You can memorize it from the phone. If you want to hang it for a day or two just to memorize it, no problem. If you're going to have it for a couple of days for memorization purposes, no problem. But yeah. Tayyib. Does the 72 sects include the Shia? It depends on which denomination of the Shia. Some of the Shia who are still within mainstream Islam, will be among the 72, and some of them that have completely left Islam, of course they're not. When you have a Shi'i who tells you that Abu Bakr is a kafir, and Umar is a kafir, and Uthman is a kafir, and Aisha is an evil woman, and that Jibreel was supposed to go to Ali, but he came to the Prophet Muhammad by mistake, and that the Quran that we have is not preserved. You want to tell me that this is from the Ummah of Muhammad and is going to be from the 72 sects? No, ya Shaykh. Taib, I have a Sufi friend who says the grave of Allah is better than the grave of Allah, is better than the Kaaba and the Arsh of Allah. What advice can I give him to correct his beliefs? You mean the grave of the Messenger of Allah? Tell him, yeah, the grave, I was about to say that makes no sense. What you can do to help him correct his beliefs is to have him attend these classes. Because he has to learn Islam from scratch. But to be very, very straightforward, tell him, okay, give me the evidence. Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Say, produce your evidences thereof if you are truthful. Tell him, bring me the evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah that says that the grave of the Prophet ﷺ is better than the Kaaba and better than the Arsh of Allah, and I will discuss it with you then. He will never be able to bring it. Yeah, what a stupid belief is this. Even the throne of Allah, Shaykh, أعظم المخلوقات, the greatest of the creation of Allah, is the throne of Allah عز وجل in terms of size. إيش الكلام الفاضي هذا؟ Off. طيب. If one of the parents has affinity to deviant ideology, how do we protect the kids from it? By correcting that parent. The parent has to be advised and corrected, and then the children shouldn't discuss matters of the deen with that person, lest they go astray. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum salam. If a girl marries a non-Muslim, will she be in hell forever? If she marries the non-Muslim and claims that it is halal, then she is going, and someone tells her, Allah says in the Quran, you know, that it is that the mushrik does not marry except the mushrika, and they cite the ayat from the Quran about the impermissibility of a Muslim woman marrying a non-Muslim. If she knows the evidence and then she still says it's halal, she's a disbeliever, she leaves Islam. However, if she does so with knowing that she is at fault and she is mistaken, then she will be leading a miserable life. Because according to the scholars, every time she has relations with him, she's committing zina. And her children are born out of wedlock. And she's in a perpetual state of disobeying Allah. And her affairs with Allah on Yawm al-Qiyamah, we don't have the right to declare anyone to be in Jahannam for 2 minutes or 5 minutes or forever or temporary, except what Allah Azza wa Jal declared. So if she doesn't do an act of disbelief, then we cannot say that this constitutes disbelief. If she's sinful, then we are all sinful. Her affairs with Allah, you never know. Allah might guide her towards the end of her life. Allahu Ta'ala A'lam. Okay, these are too many questions. This will be the last one, inshallah. The Hizb al-Tahrir is growing in my locality, not sure what their principles are exactly, and they claim to be on the truth. But Hizb al-Tahrir is from among the same methodology of Ikhwan al-Muslimin, stay away from these people and run away from them like you run away from a lion. What is the best time to do dua and prayer? Is it sunnah to raise your hands after fard prayer to do dua? The best time to make dua in your salah is in your sujood, and in whichever language you know. If you know Arabic, it's better to do it in Arabic, and before the taslim, after the tashahud and salat al-Ibrahimiyyah, and before the taslim. These are the best two times. As for raising the hands and making dua after farad, the Prophet ﷺ never did that. He never raises hands in dua after farad, so don't do it either. Okay, these are too many questions now. What was the effect on the girl's parents? What is the effect on the girl's parents for not imparting proper Islamic knowledge? They are guilty for not doing their job. Watch my series that we're having twice a week with Kalima, titled The Muslim Household. I discussed in episode 3 and episode 4. One of is the rights of the husband and wife, and one is the rights of the parents and the children. And there we discuss what obligation you have as a parent towards the children. Otherwise, if they go astray, you're responsible. The man is a shepherd and responsible for his flock. And so is the woman. طيب زاكم الله خير. Allah bless you all. We'll see you next time inshallah. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Thanks for watching this video. subscribe, and click on the notification bell. Like, comment, and share with friends and family.